Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let us receive a King. Let every heart prepare Him a road. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all His songs flow. White fields and flood, rock hills and plains. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Sing it. Joy to the world. Sing it.
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world.
Looking back at the past 4 years at HopeUC Kolkata is looking back at four seasons. We've experienced winter where we started in a global pandemic, but now we are in a time of spring where we are growing and flourishing as a family. Since the first Sunday when we started around this table with just a bunch of people, the Lord has been adding to our table ever since. And we always want to be a table community where everybody is welcome around the table and everybody can share what God is giving us and experience His generosity and love.
Church is a family where everybody belongs. Whether we are broken or with all our weaknesses, there is a seat at the table for each of us. Jesus said, "Come to me." And at HopeUC Kolkata, we've been blessed with a diverse family of people from different languages, cultures, ethnicity, races, classes. It's really a beautiful tapestry of God's kingdom.
We've also seen people believe in Jesus and have their lives transformed. People that believe that their tomorrow is greater than their yesterday. People that believe that the promises of God is yes and amen for them. People that believe that there's power and freedom and healing in the name of Jesus.
As a church, it's an honor and a privilege to do life together and to journey in this life together and see each other not only belonging but also becoming hopeful, becoming volunteers, becoming disciples, becoming the hands and feet of Jesus in this broken world as the church is meant to be. Belonging and becoming is not always easy, and just like any family, we do face lots of challenges, and it's hard sometimes to do life together. But we pray that with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, this will always be a space where we can journey together and grow closer to Jesus and look more like Him as well.
I'm so excited for what God still has in store for us. At HopeUC, we strive to do everything in excellence for the glory of God the Father. And I'm so excited to see how people will come more mature in their gifting, discover their purpose, and find a homecoming at HopeUC Kolkata.
Our heart is to build the kingdom of God and to create spaces where everyone can live and let live. Whether it's in sisters ministry or men's or love thy neighbor outreach, or whether it is young adults or Sunday school or worship services, we pray that everyone will find a place that feels like home. We are incredibly thankful for every volunteer and every person who is a part of building this small branch of God's bigger kingdom. We know that every life that enters the doors of HopeUC are very precious, and we pray that you will know love and peace above all understanding by knowing Jesus more and more.
In this Christmas season, we celebrate the lavish gift giving of God the Father and the way that He just brings His family around the table. And my prayer is that God will fill us with joy and with peace so that we can overflow with confident hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I pray that joy will increase in the city of joy. Joy to the world.
Emmanuel, come and fill our hearts, Emmanuel. Oh, Jesus, yeah, sing it out humbly. And humbly to this earth you came, born into this world to save. God with us, God with us, Emmanuel. Now we adore your name. Come on, your name, your name. Strong and mighty tower, your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder. There's nothing else above it to say your name. Jesus, in your name we pray. And Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify. Come on, shall we lift it up? Your name.
was lifted up. Strong and mighty tower, shown me. Come on, declare it. He's a shelter like no other, shown me. Let the nation see, but nothing, but nothing has the power to say. Declaration, there's nothing greater, there's nothing higher than the name of Jesus, amen. So much power. Come on, this morning, can we just lift up our hands and declare the name of God over our lives, over our situations, over our problems, over our sicknesses, over anxiety, over depression, over everything. Oh, yeah. Oh, I sing out your name, I call unto your name. Right here, right now. It's the highest, your name. It's the greatest, your name. Saints, come on, sing it all your lives. All thrones
and dominions,
all powers
and possessions,
your name. Come on, that's it, declare that. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name, and stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name. Hear your people sing, let's sing. Hear your people. holy forever.
You will always be
so holy, so
holy. Yes, Lord, you will always be holy. You are holy forever, Lord. You deserve all our praise. You deserve all the glory. And you are worthy of all our praise, Jesus. Come on, church, His presence is in this room. It was in this room even before we walked in. And He's already here. Let's invite God into our hearts this morning. Let's seek Him with all we have. Because He is worthy. He is holy. He deserves all our praise. Could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing for your goodness forevermore.
Sing it.
Worthy is your name.
Sing it out.
Lord, Lord fills this place. Your Lord serve our praise. Church, from the front to the back, let's all sing, lift our hands. What is your name?
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy.
Sing it out.
Worthy is your name.
Sing it.
Jesus. You deserve praise.
All right. Second Sunday of Advent, and we are all into this season. All right. Last week I spoke about a great light. Right? The light of Jesus that continues to shine in the past, in the present, and it's going to continue to shine in the future, okay? And we all who believe him have experienced this great light, and we got to be people who will also become reflectors of his light. Amen? That's what I was encouraging you, that come on, be a light to somebody. Be a light to someone, okay? And this morning I want to talk about a great gift, okay? Now, talking about gifts, there's a story, okay, about this lady who had some friends and she knew that she had to give them something for Christmas, okay? But she didn't want to spend any money on it. She didn't want to buy them a gift. And time was passing by and she hurriedly goes to the store and finds some cards, okay? Finds some cards on sale and she buys a couple of cards, which are nice gold trimmings along the side, and it was look perfect. On the front, it said, okay, this is a small gift from me. All right? The message on the front was generic, a gift from my heart to yours. She liked it, so she picks it up, and she begins to write and send it to her friends. Okay? And after the season, Christmas is over, she was so relieved that she could send a card to some of her friends. Okay? And after a couple of days, and she was cleaning up the house, and she began to pick up the cards that were left over, right? And she began to pick up the cards that were left over, and she opened one of the cards. And to her surprise, the card read something like this. It said, "This Christmas card is just to say a little gift is on the way." Little did she realize what she was sending. She got into trouble because of that, right? Sending cards, giving gifts are all part of our celebrations of Christmas, okay? If you look at our faith, Christianity is all about giving because God is a generous giver. He's a God who always gives into our lives, so much so that he gave his very own life to us. Okay, this is a gift all wrapped in the swaddling clothes. Jesus came as a gift into our lives. Now, if you observe Christmas changed a lot over the years, right? It's mostly commercial right now, right? It's mostly become commercial. Everything is about shopping, everything for us, okay? Can I remind you today? Christmas is not your birthday. I understand some of you were born on December 25th. That's right. But Jesus was not born on December 25th. Okay? Some of you probably don't know that. Right? But it doesn't matter. We celebrate him. We want to celebrate, all right? And sometimes we act as if it's our birthday. We want all the gifts. We want to get everything that we can, right? We act like that. But this morning, I really want to challenge us, okay, to get a different perspective of Christmas. It's not about us, but it's all about him and how we can be a reflector of who he is, okay? Right? You know, some people love buying gifts. Some people love to see the surprise on people's faces. For some people, Christmas is more of a hassle. Anyone feel like that over here? I feel that sometimes in my life. You got to go, you're under this pressure to get the right clothes, the right gift, all right? Pressure is hassle for some of it. It's a stress, right? And some of us, it can lead to depression because you don't have anything. Some of us are forced to deal with family members, which we don't like. So much pressure on us. But I want to challenge each one of us today that today, instead of overspending, right, overspending on ourselves, can we spend on someone else, right? Make someone's life brighter. You know, one of the ways we can do that, just a tip over here, you can set a budget. Yeah, budget. You know, some of us really don't believe in budgets. Robert, it's good to have a budget for Christmas. You know how much you can spend and you spend, right? Some of us are going to go into debt because of Christmas, by the way. Because you're spending money that you don't have. Right? So let this Christmas be different in our lives, okay? Now, one of the things about Christmas is we look at this great gift called Jesus. Right? Jesus, the Bible talks Jesus as a gift, okay? He gives himself to us. You know, Paul writes to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15. He says like this, says, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Thanks be to God. He is full of gratitude. This short, powerful verse has so much in it, okay? Paul begins to think about what Christ is, who Christ is, and begins to say, thank you, God. Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift. He's expressing his gratitude. We might not fully understand the magnitude of what it took for Christ to become a gift into our lives, okay? This gift is a source of transformation. This gift is a source of joy. This gift is a source of life. It's given out for each one of us, okay? It's the most wonderful gift that we all can experience, not only during Christmas, but every day of our lives. And one of the important things about this gift is that this gift is relational. Relational. What do I mean by relational? You see in John chapter 1, verse 1, it says like this. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was God from the beginning. He was not born on a day. The way they celebrate, but he existed much before that. We always have to keep that in mind. Remind ourselves again that he was not, yes, he came as a physical baby, but he was existing much before that. And the Bible clearly says in the beginning was the Word. The Word was a term that Jews used to talk about the Creator, right? And we see in the Gospels that this Creator had a name, right? Jesus. And Jesus, it says in the beginning, he existed. He was in relationship with the Father. You see, in the early creation, the Bible says, let us make man in our own image. And it talks about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit coming together, right? So we realize that he was existing much before the day we celebrate as Christmas, right? He was God all the time. But the beauty about that is, he was in relationship with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, but still he wanted to be in relationship with the people who he created. And that's why John chapter 1 verse 14 says like this. John chapter 1 verse 14 says, the Word became flesh and blood. Right? I like that. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. We saw the glory with our own eyes, the one of a kind glory, like Father, like Son. Generous inside and out, true from start to finish. That's God. The Word, he became flesh. He put some flesh on. He put some bones. And he came into our world. He came and moved into your neighborhood. We see this God who is relational, right? He's always really relational. He's not some distant God, but he came into this world so that he can develop a relationship, and everything that he does for us is through this relationship that we have with him. He is our God and we are his people. And we love him. And that's what I want to encourage each one of us today. Let's take a cue from this gift of Jesus into our lives and let him navigate, let him guide in our lives. Even as we celebrate Christmas, even as we think about gifts, come on, let's think what kind of a gift Jesus was. What kind of a gift Jesus was? Number one, Jesus was a personal gift. God's gift of Jesus is a personal gift to each one of us. Luke's account of the Christmas story, okay, talks about the birth of Christ. In Luke chapter 2, verse 11, it says like this. It says, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. You observe that it says, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. That means Rajesh is born for you, to you. Whatever your name is today, he's saying, I am your personal gift. He's born for each one of us, okay? He's born as a personal gift. Yes, he came into the world, for the world, but at the same time, he says, I came for you. Even if you were the only person that would exist in this world, he said, I would still come for you. He came for you. So this Christmas, I want us to know, he is a personal gift. For you. For you. For you out there. He is a personal gift. You know, you might have celebrated many birthdays in your life. Christmases. How many of us can remember the gifts that we get during those times? Come on, anyone can? Say what you got for your last birthday? Anyone remembers? Cash? Anyone? Watch? Dress? Some of us don't even remember. Flowers. Why? Why don't we remember? Because they were not personal. Because they were not personal. What if I ask you this question? What is the thoughtful gift that you ever received in your life? What is the thoughtful gift that you ever received in your life? Come on, anyone? Why thoughtful gifts? Because they made an effort. You know, on my birthday, on my anniversary, on my wife's birthday, my son makes some really personal gifts. Okay, and this he made for one of my birthdays. And a collection of pictures. You know, for me, this is so personal. And I will remember this. I will hang it in. Wherever I go, because it's so personal. And he does it every birthday. He takes a small canvas, he paints, and he writes different words. Dad, you're super. Dad, you're elegant. He'll put all those words and put some colors, and you ask him, why did you choose these colors? And he will give an explanation of why he chose those colors. And I would cherish those things all my life. Why? Because he made it personal. And this Christmas, that's what Jesus did for you. He made it personal. He made it personal. And I want to challenge us here today. Come on, let's make this Christmas personal. Right? In your gift giving, if you give gifts, in your celebrations, make this personal, because Jesus is a personal gift. Number two, God's gift of Jesus was also His presence. Also His presence. We celebrate Christmas because God came to this world Himself, okay? Now, there's a word that we all have heard and used, the word's called incarnation, okay? Someone who's fully human, an infant fully human, and at the same time, fully God. God came Himself into this world and lived among us, okay? And that's what unites people all across all denominations. They unite on this fact that Christ was born. And when you think about it all, it's incredible. Because God could have chosen 1,000 ways to communicate to us, right? He could have sent a prophet, right? He could have sent someone else. He could have sent an angel. He could have sent an ambassador, maybe a politician, we don't know, right? But He chose to come down Himself. So that speaks about Him coming down to spend time with humanity face to face. Now, this is a breakthrough for the Jews. You know why? Because they always heard about God, okay? But they never saw His face. They always heard about God, but they never saw His face. They didn't know this Yahweh that they were worshiping. They didn't know. They didn't ever, nobody saw Him, but they always heard about Him. And this is such a breakthrough in the lives of people. When Matthew's account of the birth of Jesus takes us back to the words of Isaiah, Matthew chapter 1 verse 23 says like this. It says, "Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call His name Emmanuel," which is translated God with us. For those Jews, this is something mind-blowing. God with us? How? How? And when they understand, if they understood that this baby, Jesus, is God Himself. You know how? Because Apostle Paul talks about it. You know, Apostle Paul talks about who Jesus is. Colossians chapter 1 verse 15 says like this. Says, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation." The Son is the image of the invisible God. They only heard His name, but they never saw Him. Okay? Few verses later, verse 19, it says like this, "For God was pleased to have all His fullness dwell in Him." In the next chapter, he says, Colossians 2 verse 9, he says, "For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form." That's incarnation, deity living in bodily form. So what Paul is saying, that if you want to know God, if you want to know who God is, he says, see Jesus. See Jesus. You don't have to look anyone to anyone else, because Jesus is the express image of His Father. Jesus is the express image of the Creator that you were worshiping. Right? And you see at Christmas, He became flesh. He came Himself into our midst. Just like one of us, physically born, okay? He ate like us. He ate like us. He lived like us. He went through suffering. He went through pain, just like you and I. Some of us are going through some difficulties and pain today, even though this is Christmas, even though we want to celebrate. We don't have that joy because there's so many things are not working in our lives. But today, I want to encourage you that His presence is always there with us. That's why His name is called Emmanuel, God with us. He can relate to you today because He lived like you and me. His presence was with us. His presence was with us. So this Christmas, I want to encourage you, give the gift of your presence. Not TS, presence as presents, presence is a CE. Why don't we give the gift of our presence to someone else? Right? Can we make this Christmas different? Say, I want to give. Instead of giving a physical gift, the gift of yourself to someone else. Light up someone's life. Look around. There are so many people hurting, needing. Come on, let's be someone else's presence. Gift of your time. Maybe you have a loved one you've never seen. Right? Gift yourself. You know, if you watch YouTube, sometimes you watch reels and Instagram reels, you always find these reels where soldiers are coming back home. Yeah? You see on these reels? And so when they come back and they surprise their family, their mom, their dad, their sisters or brothers, such an emotional time. And what could they have asked for more than that? Right? Because the presence makes everything beautiful. And the presence of Jesus into this world makes everything beautiful. So I want to encourage you, even as we go through this season of Advent, come on, let's give the gift of ourselves. Somebody else's life. That's why there are so many outreaches, right? Give the gift of yourself to someone's life. There is someone hurting out there. Give the gift of yourself. Take some time. Let's not be selfish this Christmas, but let's be thinking about how we can be a blessing. How we can be a blessing. Gift of yourself. That's what Jesus did. Talks about his very own presence coming into our lives. Number three, God's gift of Jesus was very pricey. In other words, it cost him everything. You see, John says God the Son was in loving relationship with the Father from eternity. And when Jesus leaves his Father's side to be with us, he leaves behind the splendor and the majesty of heaven. And he entered history in a humble way. Paul talks about it once again in Philippians chapter 2. Reading from verse 6 to 8, Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 5, sorry, it says like this. It says, think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. Right? It says, think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought about himself. He said, he had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantage of that status no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave, became human. Having become human, he stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges, as some of us do, right? He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life and then died a selfless, obedient death, and the worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion. It costed everything for Jesus. He was living in majesty, in splendor, in glory, angels worshiping him, bowing down to him. And when the Father had asked his Son to come to this earth, he left everything. He left all his majesty. He left all his glory. And he came as a little baby. Came as a little baby. Who needed help? Who needed help for himself? Think about that. He was God. He wasn't as a baby. But he said, I'm willingly let go. I'm willingly let go of my privileges. I'm willingly let go of my authority. He came as a humble person into this world. It costed him everything, my friends. Following Christ always costs us. Living for Christ always costs us. And giving relationally will always cost us. He was born in a cradle to die on the cross. That's his purpose. So that you and I can enjoy the gift of eternal life. That's what Romans says. The wages of sin is death, But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. He came, he died, so that you and I can enjoy life eternally. And eternal life does not start when you go to heaven. It starts now. The moment you receive Jesus, it says, my eternal life has come into you. You know, everything that you purchase, every gift that you want to give will cost us. Right? Cost us money, time, and thought. But the memorable ones will be always ones that will that are priceless. Priceless. I can remember one of my birthdays. I think it's my 40th birthday. My wife had a surprise party for me. I didn't even have a clue about it. I was living with her, going about doing our work every day. I didn't have a clue that she's inviting all my friends to come into our homes, and she took me out that day. And by the time I came home, there were a whole bunch of people right there celebrating my birthday. Priceless. Priceless. Jesus' gift was priceless. And in our celebrations, can we become like him? Can we give to one another something that is valuable? Something that is treasure, which cannot put money on it? What can that be? What can be that in your, for your family? What can that be for the, someone who is in your workplace? What can that be someone who is in your community? What can that be someone who is in your neighborhood? What can that be? Something priceless, but it will cost you. It will cost you your time. It will cost you your energy. It will cost you your creativity. Because Jesus was such a kind of gift who was priceless. He gives. He keeps on giving. He's a gift that keeps on giving. He doesn't stop. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but will have everlasting or eternal life. Jesus came willingly, my friends. He paid the high price for it. He paid the high price for you and me. He served us. Mark chapter 10 verse 45 says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He came to give his life. Costly. Costly. Not only God's gift was costly, but whoever receives him will have to pay the price for it. Right? You see in the story of Christmas, it cost Joseph a lot, Mary's fiance. It cost Joseph his reputation. Right? Think about it. The girl he was supposed to get married, she comes one day and say, look, I'm pregnant. Think about his reputation. He must have thought, what? I did not even come close to you. But Joseph believed in her. He did not divorce her or shame her in any way. It cost him his reputation. Probably he had to run out of his hometown because he could. How many people could he answer? Why is Mary pregnant? How come Mary is pregnant? Think about that. I know the story is so beautiful when you think about it, but if you look into the intricacies of the story, it is difficult. What would he say to people? How come Mary is pregnant? It cost his probably his dreams. He had to let go of everything. And choosing Christ sometimes, it will cost us. I know so many families, I visit so many families, and they tell about the stories of how they came to Jesus Christ, and it costed them everything. They were living off very well one point at a time. Just because they believed in Jesus, they were asked to get out of their homes. Out of the inheritance. It will cost us. But that cost is a very good cost in our lives. Receiving God's gift cost the Magi too. They were looking for this king. Right? They go to Herod, and Herod says, I also don't know. So he he asks his advisors and they tell him he's born in such and so. They go and visit the place. They offer their gifts. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the Magi and asked them to return to a different home. And when the king realized, he could have realized they had deceived him. He probably wanted to kill them, find out and kill them too. It will cost us, my friends. And this Christmas, I really want to encourage you. Let's count the cost. Let's count the cost in our celebrations. What it took Jesus and what it would take you and me to become that light. What it would take for you and me to become that gift to brighten someone else's life. That's why we have these outreaches. Because we want to help people. We want to help you to plug in so that we can make a difference in the lives of people. The lives of people. So the challenge for today is that during this season, I want us to spend less on ourselves. Okay? Breathe. Yeah? Spend less on ourselves. Can we come to a place of generosity? And give more so that we can become people like Jesus. You know, something Rick Warren always talks about. It says, generosity makes us like God. Because God is a generous God. He always keeps giving. And so when you reflect that one of his characters of generosity, you act like God. And this Christmas, I really want to challenge us today. Come on, let's be generous. Let's give the gifts of ourselves. Because that's going to make it personal. And that's going to make it priceless. So in our celebrations, can we be people who will think about those things today? So how can you be practical? So many ways you can be practical. You know, there are so many people who don't have families in this congregation who come from different cities. Why don't you just host a celebration? Just for them and say, find them, invite them into your homes for Christmas because they don't have anywhere to go. Come on. Gather together as a life group, as friends together, go help out in the outreach. Find a couple who are struggling to get some time out. Why don't you help them? Say, okay, I'll take care of your kids. Just go out, enjoy your day. So many ways. If you're not spending time, enough time with your kids, come on, shut off everything. Spend some time with your kids. Gift of yourselves. That's what kids need. Not any more gadgets, my friend. Sometimes that's what we do as parents. Because we don't have time, we give them gadgets. But I tell you, the gift of yourself is something priceless. Find ways so that you can be relational. Find ways so that you can be valuable this Christmas. Let's make this Christmas different. Just like Jesus is a personal and a pricey gift, can we be the same like Jesus today? Gift of his presence. Can we gift ourselves to someone this Christmas? Make it brighter in somebody else's life. Just close your eyes for a moment. Let the Spirit of God speak to you today. God's gift of Jesus was personal. God's gift of Jesus was his presence face to face. God's gift of Jesus was pricey. And maybe you are here today. You never received this gift into your life. You never asked Jesus to come into your life and received him as your Lord and Savior. Today, I want to give you that opportunity today to receive him, to receive this gift, valuable, precious gift. He came and he died for you on the cross. Shed his precious blood so that you and I can enjoy eternal life. Some of us have received him. Some of us are still out there trying to find out. This morning, I want to give you that opportunity to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Receive this gift with faith. That's all it requires. Faith and belief in him. So if there is anybody in this congregation who never received Jesus into your life as your Lord and Savior, I just want you to lift up your hand wherever you are. I want to help you out. Lead you in a prayer to do that. Anyone else, anyone here today? Just lift up your hands higher. Thank you. Anyone, lift up your hands higher. This is a great decision today. You're receiving the gift of all gifts. The greatest gift of all. This gift will transform your life. Come on, anyone else out there before I pray today? Thank you. Thank you. And all those people who lifted up their hands, I want to lead you in a simple prayer of faith today. And at Hope Unlimited Church, we believe in the family praying together. So come on, family, let's pray this together. Heavenly Father, come on, say it out loud. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your son Jesus to die for me on the cross of Calvary. Jesus, I realize I am a sinner and I ask you to forgive all my sins and cleanse me with your precious blood. Jesus, I believe in you with all my heart and confess you with my mouth that you are Lord. Come live inside of me by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, we just thank you, Lord. I pray, Spirit of God, who's making that decision for the very first time, I pray that your understanding and revelation will be upon them today, oh God. We bless them today, Lord. Come on, rest of us, let's all stand up in his presence. Come on, this gift of Jesus, you got to acknowledge him today. You got to lift up your voice and begin to worship him and say, thank you. Thank you, God, for this indescribable gift. We worship you, Jesus. Come on, lift your voice and begin to worship him.
Oh, come, let us adore. Oh, come, let us adore.
If this message means something to you today, I just want to lift up your hands and surrender and say, God, I want to be like you. I want to be like you, Jesus, today. This season, all through my life, I want to be reflecting you in everything that I do, oh God. Someone, call across this place. If you believe in this, just lift up your hand and say, God, help me to reflect you today. So here we are, God, hands lifted up in surrender. And say, God, we thank you for this great gift, for this beautiful gift, for this indescribable gift of Jesus, who became so personal, oh God, that he came down to this earth face to face to live among us, to live like us, oh God. We thank you, Jesus, for that. And today, oh God, even as we stand in your presence, Lord, we want to be like you, oh God. We want to reflect you, oh God. We want to be these people, Lord, just as you are, giving, generous. Help us to be like that throughout this season and throughout our life, oh God. Thank you, Jesus, for that, oh God. Thank you, Lord, for that today. We give you all praise. We give you all glory. We give you all honor today. Even as we go out, I pray, Lord, that we'll find opportunities, oh God. Look for opportunities in our workplaces, in our communities, in our neighborhoods. Lord, wherever we go, we'll find our opportunities to give the gift of our presence, oh God. Make someone else's life brighter and better. We thank you, God, for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. So glad to have you all here this morning. If you made that prayer to receive Jesus, I want you to do me a favor. Please go down to our prayer room, which is downstairs. One of our team members will be there to help you out and pray with you. If you need prayer for any other need you have, you can still visit our prayer room downstairs. If you are new here and you're here for the very first time, outside that door, there is a place called the guest lounge. Please go there, meet one of our team members, and per exchange of your information card, you can get a coffee coupon on us. God bless you, church. Give the gift of yourself. Amen. We don't close our service without speaking the blessing of God over our lives. So it will be on screen. So let's speak this over our lives together. Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1. I pray that God, who is the source of hope, will fill us completely with joy and peace, because we place our trust in Him. Then we will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you, church. Give the gift of yourself to somebody during this season.
He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of His righteousness and wonders of His love, and wonders of His love, and wonders one.
Have a great week, church. See you next Sunday.